You know what? We all have our 15 minutes of fame, and I'd like to take a couple of my 15 minutes to talk about the rights and the wrongs in the world of professional wrestling.
This match is for the ECW World Heavyweight Championship!
Wow, World Championship belt.
This is the most prestigious belt in wrestling.
Fabulous. Lana Starr has it. Everyone wants...
Bring me the belt!
I want the belt.
And I could definitely see myself going for that title match.
I'm coming for that belt because it belongs to me.
If you think you're coming anywhere close to this, you've got another thing coming.
One by one, I will go through your entire roster until the only person that's left is Lana Starr.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is Mr. Green, and you are listening to the WOW Superheroes Review. Some time ago, I put up an episode on the WPN YouTube channel saying it's WOW, do or die. And basically stating that, you know, that the pushing back and the pushing back and the pushing back of the episodes, the promises that they were putting out that didn't quite come through, that had to cease because their fans were beginning to lose faith. Some of them were losing hope. And at some point, I'm just going to go ahead and point out that some of them have lost faith. I'm not even sure if all of them have come back just based on the numbers that they have on their individual channels and the amount of people have watched. I think they just got some people that have walked away. But I'm here to say now is that they have begun to produce episodes, or I shouldn't say produce. They have begun to release episodes of WOW. They've already been produced, and now you are beginning to get access to them. So for those of you that were kind of waiting around and looking and trying to see what the news was as far as WOW is concerned, I am here now to report it that there are episodes that are being released for the public to watch. Now, before we go off on that, we need to define what the episodes are for WOW Superheroes before you go on and people start to get upset or feel like they were misled. I know there was a couple of people that put some comments on their sites that the episodes need to be more than a match long, and that's what it is. The episodes are a single match long, which is essentially the same thing that we do here on the WPN. You know, when we produce the matches here, or we produce the episodes here, they are a match. You know, it's open and a close, and the match in between. Usually that runs us about 15, 25, possibly 30 minutes, depends on the length of the match. But they are doing something very similar to what we do. I think the only thing that works against them in this particular instance is that it's been promoted as full episodes for so long that people expected full episodes, and particularly the people that have watched WOW from day one, you know, the ones that are looking at it from back in 2000. If you're not familiar with those, the episodes were basically an hour. They had a start, a finish. They had segments that took place in between and so on and so forth. And you're not getting that with this. You're getting the match and a couple of notes about it, maybe in between that. So it's not in full bloom. So again, you know, I certainly cannot criticize the release of a single match because, again, that's what the WPN does. But the WPN, we do that because we're getting matches from several different sources. So let me clarify that. That it is the reason that our episodes are singularly a match. Every once in a while, we put a bonus in there or something like that. But it's singularly a match because we get it from different sources. We have partnerships with different promotions, Universal Independent Wrestling, Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, Roar, which is a sister promotion of Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, Deep South, and a couple of others. We were fortunate enough to get some stuff sent in from WXW. So that is the reason why we have our stuff the way that we have it. While, again, I think that it kind of worked against them in that, you know, there was a lot of anticipation behind it. And some people may have felt let down. But, you know, it is what it is. And you shouldn't feel that let down behind it. I think they're cutting it up as best they can. And probably so they can stretch this thing out. You have to remember that if they break it down or if they lump it together into full hour-long episodes, then there's not going to be much of it left. If you look at maybe a good three of them, you'd probably be done. So there it is. That is the first thing. So let's get into the review of what they have begun to offer you. As of right now, as I'm recording this, and this is just before the release of episode 3, there are is technically 4 videos out there. One you got during the holidays, which is a tag team match where they offered just as a kind of a preview. It's an unofficial episode that they gave you. They gave you episode 1, which is essentially just an intro to everything. Episode 2, which is a match. And then there's the trailer. Well, I should say more than 4, actually. There's a couple of trailers that they kind of recycled. They aren't episodes, but they are available for you to watch. And there's also kind of background clips that's available for you to watch. But going into the bulk of the review here, because we want to get through this kind of quick. Episode 1 is listed as New Generation. And you can see these on WOW. That's WOWE.com. They have the links there for all of the episodes to get you right into it. As I just stated, it's basically an intro video. One, it gives you a quick glimpses of all the wrestlers in WOW. And two, it's the setup for the first official match of WOW second season, which is Azucar versus Frost. That is the first official release. Let's rewind this just for a second so I can, for those that haven't paid attention to WOW or watched WOW or don't know what's going into it, we at least let's talk about the thing that sets them into their second season. Very quick, WOW began originally in 2001. Sorry. It began in 2000. It began at the end of 2000, somewhere around September, I believe. So it began in the end of 2000, and it ran until 2001. Now, WOW has claimed that they did another show or they had another match somewhere in 2002, but we're going to say officially when WOW ceased this television, when the show was removed or canceled, however you choose to determine that, it ended in 2001. So it ran 2000, 2001. At that time, you had roughly 2 champions that came through WOW. Terry Gold was being the first, won the Battle Royal. Danger beat her for the championship. Terry Gold won it back at the pay-per-view. WOW claims that Lana Starr then defeated Terry Gold somewhere in 2002 at an independent event that, you know, they say that they sanctioned. But we're going to just lump that under the same category as the fictional Intercontinental Championship tournament that took place in Brazil that the WWE always claimed that, oh, yeah, the tournament that crowned the first champion took place in Rio de Janeiro, which never happened. They just said that because there was no way that anybody could back it up or follow them or anything like that. And that's basically the same thing you have here. Until WOW pulls out some video or something like that to prove me differently, prove me wrong, it's a fictional title change. It never happened. Some people ask me about it. Well, can we see the footage? Is it out there somewhere? No, it's not out there. Doesn't exist. Lana Starr was just crowned the champion, and that was an easy, convenient way to give it to her. The tag team championships, there has only been one set of tag team champions as it came out of the first season. That was Cage Heat, which has dealt a lot of pain, and Loka. Although they did get a third member, I can't remember. I think Vendetta. Vendetta was her name. They got her on basically the tail end of WOW. She came in as the third member at the pay-per-view, and I think she might have did a television episode, and that was about it. So they held the tag team championships right until WOW deactivated. Now, WOW also claims that Cage Heat just held on to the titles. They just held it. Same way the Atlanta Star just held the championship. So both of these champions have in excess of 4,000 days of being champion, although they've never defended these titles anywhere between that time. WOW is somehow counting that as part of their championship reign, which is absurd. That's just my opinion. It's absurd to have a champion that just holds on to a title regardless of whether they have defended it or not. But, you know, that's just the old school in me. The production value of the show is great, and the editing is pretty good. And I'm going to just say right now that I am going to nitpick at some video production or editing that goes on in there, because that's kind of what I'm trained at doing. So I'm just warning you now. Yeah, there are certain things that I nitpick at least in that. I can't help it, but it shouldn't hurt your viewing experience watching that, just from me talking about camera angles or whatever the case may be. I also want to say that when you're looking at the show, the feel of the show is like an old school wrestling show. It's basically the same thing that WOW was, with the addition of reality TV elements kind of being tossed in there, and a little bit of what Lucha Underground does. If you've never watched Lucha Underground, the backstage vignettes are very much kind of telenova or kind of movie-esque, if you want to call it that. And WOW has a little bit of that too. Not nearly as polished as Lucha Underground. I mean, Lucha Underground is amazing if you haven't seen it. And I know that's a side note and that's a plug for them. But not nearly as good, but it's good. You know, that from the little bit of the clip that I saw in episode one, again, this is all out of that. They have a little segment where Jezebel Bell Smothers is kind of approaching Barbie Hayden, which on the show they're known as Jesse James and Abilene Maverick. And you could tell that was either a two-camera shoot or something like that, which you don't get off of most wrestling shows. Most wrestling shows kind of push towards the reality. It's that single-camera shoot. We're just going to follow you in, and we're going to catch the confrontation as it happens. But that one seemed like that was a little bit more of an acting job, so you can expect some of those down the line. If you're listening to this, there's a good chance that you are a hardcore or pure wrestling fan, or that you're kind of the guy that likes some of those the women of the independent circuit. So let's clarify this before we go into the bulk of the review. If you are that type of fan, there are going to be some of these matches that just will not jive with you. If you are looking for those kind of matches, take in account that the ladies on the roster, some of them at least, are not as polished as others. So the matches will not be as good as what you're getting in a Shine or a Shimmer or a WSU or even on this channel for that matter. Just take the show for what it is. WOW follows the same basic formula that it did 10 years ago. It's colorful costumes, colorful characters, and that's the basic selling point of WOW. So you have been warned. Do not expect, a 20-minute ball buster match or, you know, something like you see on NXT with Bayley taking on Sasha Banks. You're not going to get that. That's too advanced. It's just too advanced for them. Anyway, first, the holiday episode, Tropical Storm, which is La Niña and Paradise, who is the returning competitor in this contest, taking on the Bully Busters, is Keita Rush and Stephanie La Maravillosa. There we go. Now, this episode opens up with the Del Sol marching band leading the Bully Busters to the ring. They get the hero's entrance. And I thought that was really nice. I thought it was good showmanship to have them kind of get led into the ring to kind of remind me of WrestleMania 1 when Piper was being led to the ring by a band. So I thought that was a nice touch. Tropical Storm comes out just through the normal entrance way with the music playing, and they come out as the assumed heels. And I'll get into that after I talk about the match. There's nothing too outrageous here or anything that really I should go out my way to mention. It is the basic WOW match. And there are certain things that in a WOW match you're going to get. You're going to get the arm crank where they twist it and they jump up and down for about three times and then they go to the next spot, or it's a side headlock and they crank up and down on that three times before they go to the next spot. It's just, you know, it's just what they're taught. It's really no other way to put that. It's just what they're taught. And if they were trained by, say, multiple trainers, if they had the experience that a lot of the girls on indies have where they're coming from different places and they're working against different girls and they get different experiences and different styles and stuff like that, then that might be different. But WOW is a very... for lack of a better term, we're going to say a very sanitized training environment where you have that one style and most of them are not working against someone that's better. And that's the only way that you're going to get better in the ring is if you're working against somebody that's better than you. But we'll move on from that. But I have to say, most of the girls in here probably had training for about 3 months or so. So you take that for what it's worth. The tag team match is pretty basic. You got the heels, assumably Tropical Storm, who are going to beat up on the babyface for a little while before she is able to break free and get the tag. And then they kind of beat up the heels for a moment, which is pretty much what happened. But there is a spot in there that bothers me. And these are one of the things that I kind of go back to the trainer for. Keita Rush is being double teamed in the corner. In the corner of Tropical Storm. Her partner, Stephanie, charges in to save her, but she charges towards the referee, which comes off to me like, let me make sure I do my spot properly. Because you know that the referee needs to stop her. You know, we've seen this in tag team wrestling hundreds of times. We know that the referee has to stop her, then walk her back to her side as she argues with him, while it gives the heels of time to double team further. But I would have preferred if she actually looked like she was charging in to save her partner and the referee dove in the way to stop her from doing it. Here it just came off to me like, okay, I know what my next spot is. Let me make sure the ref catches me. And I didn't like that. That's just me. You watch it and leave your comments below. Tell me if you spot it or was it just me. there was a hot tag that happened, or hot tag spot that happens here. Following that double team, Leninia and Keita Rush get up. There's a point where they both seem hesitant, as if not really knowing what to do next, and then Leninia nails her with a clothesline and sets her down on the mat. But almost as if no selling the clothesline, Keita Rush manages to roll over to her partner and make the tag. Meanwhile, on the other side of the ring, despite seeing clearly that Keita has rolled across the ring to safety, for whatever reason, Leninia is standing up, talking to a partner, and jawing about something. That spot or those things happen frequently in WOW, where for whatever reason, despite the fact that I've seen that you've ducked the clothesline or you leaped out of the way or somehow or other, you've dodged whatever offensive maneuver that I tried to apply, they stop and they start talking to somebody. I don't know why. It just happens that they'll either start talking to the fans or they start talking to the partner or just not reacting as if I am in danger because I missed this move. And that gets me. But we'll move on. So Lenine is talking to a partner. Stephanie gets the tag from Keita Rush, who's made the hot tag over there. Now, they come in, they do the hero thing, they're beating them up. The Bully Busters take control for a moment. There's a blind tag from Paradise, which she tags off to her partner, Lanine, which wasn't called by the play-by-play. So if you watching that, you may not know that Paradise is now the legal woman. She made the tag. It just isn't called for whatever reason. Tropical Storm tosses Stephanie out of the ring. They catch Kida with a double kick, which bends her over and sets her up for the double DDT. Tropical Storm wins. Following that, they then get to address the audience, and they're now being kind of hyped up as almost as baby faces, because they're talking about, you know, Paradise is the returning wild girl, and she knows what it's like to have to go out to championships, and this is her hometown, and, you know, she's clapping and kind of trying to get the crowd into it and all that good stuff. So I'm not really sure what Tropical Storm is supposed to be. I'm not sure if they're supposed to be baby faces. I'm not sure if they're supposed to be heels. They started off as heels. They behaved as heels throughout the most part of the match. But at the end of the match, it's okay, we're baby face, or we're kind of baby face, or we're anti-hero, or something like that. I prefer it just, you know, give me right down the line. You know, let me know whether you're baby face or heel, and I can adjust accordingly from that point. That is what I would have liked out of that. But all in all, it was entertaining, you know, to say the least, which is essentially what I would expect. But there certainly could have been a higher grade of tag team match. But for what their experience dictates, this is probably the best that you were going to get. You're probably no longer going to see Tropical Storm should WoW continue. Lalina, for some of you that do watch Lucha Underground, would now know her as Melissa Santos. And she works with Lucha Underground now, and they've been picked up for season 2 and 3. So I do not see any reason for Melissa to leave that promotion as it stands right now. So Paradise may have to acquire a new partner if Tropical Storm is going to proceed past this point. Episode 2, which is titled Cold War, features Frost versus Azucar. Azucar being their luchadora. Frost, to clarify, is not the replacement for Ice Cold, which was in the first season. We had this interview on this channel. If you have not heard it, you can go and listen to her speak about that. She said the Frost character has nothing to do with the fact that there was an Ice Cold preceding her. This is something that she got while she was on the bobsled team. That was her nickname. In order to get the full idea behind this match, you need to watch the preceding clips, which contain essentially backstage information. If I didn't say it already, you have those on WoW, on their YouTube channel. You have the condensed version of all of these matches. I prefer it be all collected in one video, but that's me. Again, the matches are pretty standard, but it's played up to have these background issues between Frost and Azucar. Those issues being Azucar and Frost almost were friends during the training portions of WoW. And then Azucar begins to notice that Frost is a bit of a bully. She's talking about almost everybody behind their back. She's talking about, you know, how this person sucks or how that person sucks. And then Azucar begins to believe, well, if you talk about these people behind their back, what do you say about me when I'm not there? So that begins the dissension of Azucar and Frost. You have Frost, who gives her version of the interview where she's talking about, I don't know who this chick is. She comes in, she wears a mask, she wore it in training, she wears it to lunch. You know, more or less getting to the point where she is promising to take it off. And we move towards the match. Now, again, the match is separate from the background information, so you got to kind of look through for all of those. The same spot that happened that I was just talking about in the holiday episode happens here, where Azucar kind of flips over Frost, and for whatever reason, Frost starts jawing with the fans. I don't know why. The thing that I will say that I like about Frost is that she very definitively and clearly makes it that she is the heel. She goes out of her way to be disliked in this environment, and I think that she worked really hard at that. She, all of the stuff that they said about her in the commentary also is very accurate. She, you know, being fluent in sign language and the bobsled and being a part of the Olympics and so on and so forth, that none of that stuff is made up. That's all true. And I will also say that her athletic style can also be played up to the fact that she is a stunt woman. So she has that going for her also. And they talk up those things like essentially to give her additional credibility. The same way they did with Azucar, where they talk about the history of the mask and, you know, how her mother brought her to matches when she was young so she could, you know, she establish her background in wrestling with that. The match, relatively short. All of them are fairly short. They're about 5 minutes on the average. You get fluff in the episodes. There's stuff that precedes the match. We talk about, you know, the full-blown entrance, the music, the pageantry, and all that stuff, like the video that gets played, the talking up that goes on behind it. There's fluff in front of and there's fluff behind the matches. So if you remove that and you take that away, the matches are average about 4.5 minutes, which is probably what they're capable of carrying at this point in their wrestling career. They did the same thing, the twist and armbar crank, the side headlock crank. This is the point where I start to get nitpicky. When you're looking at the video, that every time that there's, well, almost every time that there's a hit or kick or drop kick, for the most part, not all the time, but for the most part, it's a cut on the action. A cut on the action means that, and I'm going to use the movie analogy, when you're watching a movie, for the most part, they cut between the punches. If somebody tosses a punch, they cut to the opposite end so you cannot see whether the punch actually connected or not. There are a couple of movies where that isn't a rule, where they, you know, say like Rocky Balboa, where they actually were hitting each other. But when you're looking at most action films or something like that, they cut on the action so that they can give you the illusion of the hit without actually having the actors give hits to each other. Well, that's what you have here. You got the illusion of the hit, because most often, if there's a kick, cuts to a different angle. If there's a punch, cuts to a different angle. If there's a clothesline, cuts to a different angle. The only time that they did not do that is when they solidly made some sort of connection. And I know that's to protect the integrity of the match, or try to protect the integrity of the competitors there. So you know that, okay, they're working hard or whatever the case may be, but in a wrestling environment, somehow that takes away. Or somehow it takes away to see the cut on every single, you know, almost every single punch or every single kick. It gives me the impression that they're not connecting at all. Especially when most other wrestling promotions or most other wrestling shows, they try to minimize the cut on the action. They try to let you see a lot of stuff and let you see the connection, let you see the impact, let you see the slam, let you see the suplexes and all of that stuff like that. But with the amount of experience that they have in there, is very likely that, well, they needed to do that for protection. The match ends when Frost begins to work over the legs of Azucar and ultimately sets her up for a figure four leg lock. Azucar, in the figure four leg lock, manages to crawl herself or pull both herself and Frost towards the ropes, and she grabs onto the bottom, which, of course, in wrestling constitutes a break. Frost, being Frost and being the heel here, is counting along with the referee as he's saying 1, 2, and she's going along with him, and she refuses to break the hold. She instead cranks down harder to either break her leg or cause some sort of permanent injury, which causes her to lose. The match is won by Azucar by disqualification, and extra referees run out the ringside to get Frost off of her. Now, I did not have a problem with this end. I did not have a problem with Frost cranking down on her or being the mean girl or, you know, being the heel. And I'm refusing to release the hold. The only thing that I had to say beyond that point, if she's going to play the heel, or at least that type of heel, because when you watch it, Frost comes off as the one girl there that I don't have any friends. I don't care who it is. I don't, you know, I'm here to do me, and that's that. And that's fine. I like that. I like her being just the solo heel, because that, you know, not here to make friends. Just let me do what I'm doing. But if she's going to do that, I don't get the effort of saying that I'm going to be the champion or bring me the belt. Clearly, especially when you know that you are doing or have done something that's going to cause you to lose. So if anything, that's pushing you further away from the championship than it is pushing you forward towards the championship. You just gave up a loss. You have no justified reason to ask for a championship match. You have no justified reason to tell somebody to bring me the belt. But it does play into the arrogance of Frost. It does play into her being, you know, I'm better than everybody else. Bring me the belt. I would prefer that her initial goals is just to cause pain. And following eliminating everybody where there's no one left, then I will go for the championship. Now, she did tell me during the course of our interview, and again, if you haven't listened to it, it is here. It's available online right now for you to go onto our page or our channel and listen to it full. She did say that she had every intention of getting the championship, and I fully believe her. She comes off on a normal interview as if that championship means everything in the world, and that she isn't there to play for friends, this and that. So it's less of an act that most people would probably give it credit for. But again, I like her. Did not get much of Azucar's personality. She just came off as an opponent to me. And if the announcers or the play-by-play did not talk her up, I probably wouldn't know anything about her at all. They did give, you know, videos showing the mask being made and talking about her background and stuff like that. But I think Frost's personality is so big and so overpowering that it basically swallows Azucar up. It's like, you know, the only thing that you're kind of left with following looking at that match is Frost. She's the first thing that you see, and then she's the last thing that you see. So it just kills whatever personality that Azucar had or that she may have left inside of that match. She just wiped that out. Now, the only other thing with these episodes, or at least this episode, is that during the course of it, you can tell that it is part of a larger show that is just being chopped up. And if you're looking for something other than that, sorry. You're going to lose it there. Now, the other bit of nitpicking things that I have is that for whatever reason, when it cuts from one camera to the next, the visual alters a little bit. And again, this is somebody talking from a technical standpoint. But some camera angles seem a little bit, or some camera visuals seem a little bit more purple than others. Some of them seem a little brighter. You know, some of them seem like a normal size. Like every camera is filtered a little differently, and I don't know why that is. I know that is not me. No, it's not my eyes. Everything else that I've looked at that's been on TV and this computer screen has been perfectly fine. It's just been that. It's just the visuals there. It's a very minute thing, but that happens. Also, I can tell that there's a lot of things that's being done in post, and there's nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that, but there's a lot of stuff that's being done in post, such as the cheering and the boos. The cheering and the boos, that's being done in post. That crowd is dead. You can look at any episode on there. That crowd is dead. They're sitting on their hands. They're just sitting there watching. Some people into it. You can see a couple of people kind of clapping or something like that, but they are just sitting around doing nothing. it's almost like they're giving no energy to those girls. And I don't know if that's just the crowd because they're tourists and they may not necessarily be wrestling fans. They may just be coming there to watch a TV taping. But they are, that crowd is not good. It's just, they suck. There's really no other way to put it. But you got a few people in there that enjoy what they're doing. But a lot of that noise that you're hearing, that's just canned cheers, it's canned boos. They're doing it on the cue. I'm sure there are some applause that's coming from the audience, but not nearly what there is being edited to be. The voiceovers, I can see that the announcers are not calling the match right then and there. That voiceover work is kind of coming in later. But that doesn't bother me either because I do the same thing. But I'm just, you know, I'm not on camera to show differently. I'm not the guy sitting at the at ringside at the table at the microphone and not calling it there. I call it back at the audio booth. Same way as they probably did there. All in all, it is a fun little thing to watch. Very quick, very easy. Doesn't stretch out. Doesn't feel like it drags on. But again, I will repeat the same warning that I did for those people, because I know on this channel I get a lot of people that are hardcore wrestling fans. The ones that did look at NXT, the ones that did look at Shimmer and Shine and WSU and WPN, All Girls or Girl Fight, you know, any number of these places that I named. I know that, you know, a lot of people that are listening to this are those type of people. And if that's the type of match or that you're looking for, if that's the kind of caliber of match that you're wanting to see, you may want to wait and see if you can get up to the matches where the actually trained girls are in there. Because I don't want to make it sound like WOW doesn't have anybody in there of merit. They have Barbie Hayden, Santana Garrett, Amber O'Neill, Jesse Bell Smothers. You know, all of those girls are well-trained. Hudson Envy, who's there at Spike and wrestling mostly in Japan now. And to say nothing of the fact that the last three NWA Women's World Champions all were part of the WOW roster. And Barbie Hayden, who won it from Casey Carlisle, wasn't part of WOW, but she won it from Casey Carlisle and then lost hers to Santana Garrett, who then lost hers to her former tag team partner, Amber Gallows. I should call her Gallows now because she is married. So there's talent there. There's talent on that roster. We just haven't seen them yet. We're starting off with the opening matches, and I know the next match that is advertised there is a championship match of Lana Starr, who is the reigning WOW champion, coming in to defend against newcomer Sunshine. Again, the condensed version of that match is online, so you can see who won right now. But if you're waiting to see the full version of that match, then you're going to have to wait to March 11th when they release the next episode, episode 3. And that should be interesting, to say the least. We don't know what the ranking system or how they rank or why they do certain things, so we'll just call it as it goes. But that's the first review, folks. That's it. We're going to follow this from start to finish. Hopefully I will be able to pull in a guest reviewer with me down the line. I've been talking to a couple of people, so you won't just get my opinions about it. You'll get the opinions of some of the participants, depending on who it is. I'm not going to mention any names right now because it hasn't been solidified. And perhaps we can get a girl or two that is outside a while so they can get a very true and unbiased opinion. So that might be fun to have. If I'm going to give this a grade before I go, I'm going to give it a solid C. Give it a C+. Now that it's not a bad show, but nothing there was overall nothing gave me just like shivers, like, man, I gotta run back and I gotta watch this next episode, especially in today's women's wrestling environment. I can't say it enough, in the environment now where we have a phenomenal match, outstanding match, which, by the way, won PWI Match of the Year over Guys, okay? This match won Match of the Year for 2015 over everything. Sasha Banks versus Bayley at NXT Brooklyn. You know, that right there says something. So, you know, that bar for what women's wrestling is has been set very, very high. And it's going to be difficult for anybody, much less Wild, to kind of get to that bar. But who knows, man? I might get surprised. They may have some gold in the hard drives over there and surprise us all. So that's it. You got the ratings. You got the review. And make sure that you come back and join us for the next episodes. If you haven't subscribed to this channel, please do. The subscriptions matter, man. They really do. The subscriptions for this channel, the likes for Facebook, the follows for Twitter, all of that stuff matters because it means that we can keep this thing going. We can keep producing episodes. We can keep doing reviews. It makes the sponsors know that somebody out there is listening and they get to hear their stuff. So if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe. It would do us a solid favor, man. And we really appreciate that. And that's it. And one last thing, the last interview with a very good wrestler, very outspoken wrestler, Queen of the Southeast, Stormy Lee, is available right now. The links are kind of screwed up. I've been trying to repost that, but for whatever reason, YouTube has jacked it all up. So I may have to redo it. But if you haven't listened to it, give it a listen. It's good stuff. She's very entertaining. And that's it, folks. That's going to do it for me right now. And we will catch you on the next review. Come back for some more matches. And that's it, folks. We're out. See you next time.
Thank you for listening to the WPN's Rights and Wrongs of Pro Wrestling. If you have questions or comments, please contact us via our Facebook or our YouTube channel at the Women's Pro Wrestling Network. If you're new to the WPN, feel free to subscribe to our channel and like our page. We appreciate your support. Thank you again for listening.